I have 10 minutes to share something that I can probably take 2 days to talk about. My name is Jonathan. I'm a medical oncologist. I'm going to talk about the genetics and genomics of prostate cancer and really focus on the implications and sort of the practical aspects of current and future patient care. So I just want to take a brief detour back to high school biology, probably, for some of us, but to just recognize and to state out loud that prostate cancer cells, just like every other cells in our body, are made up of DNA, RNA, and proteins. And so these DNA, so the DNA is made up of four different bases that we call A, T, G, and C. You can see the full names here in the left panel. And there are two key hallmarks that make prostate cancer, any cancer, actually a cancer. And those are that the genetic instructions within those cells end up leading to either uncontrolled proliferation, meaning the cells are continuously dividing, or they lead to a decrease in apoptosis, which is another word for cell death. Okay. And so what do I mean when I talk about cancer genetics and genomics? It's really the understanding of the changes that occur within the DNA, the RNA, and the protein levels that make those proliferation and those changes in cell death. And in fact, we also know now that the DNA is wrapped up in these proteins called histones that can actually change how the message is actually read. Because if we have DNA that's really wound up in these histones, those messages can't be actually seen in the cell. So how can we use genetics and genomics in terms of prostate cancer care? So I'm gonna highlight three ways that I think about it when I meet a patient in clinic. And the first thing is identifying genes that might put a patient or his family at risk for developing prostate cancer. And so this is really thinking about the family tree and thinking about early detection and screening for other family members, as well as screening for the patient. So for patients who have a big family history where multiple brothers, grandfathers, fathers, uncles, et cetera, have prostate cancer, it really changes the way that I think about the patient. The second thing that Dr. Cooperberg talked a little bit about, he used a different analogy, the rabbits and the turtle, but I'll use separating the lions from the kittens. So thinking about people who have indolent disease versus those who have more aggressive disease biology, the tigers in the room. And the last thing is that thinking about how do we use the information to actually tailor our treatments accordingly. So is there, in other words, an Achilles heel in those mutations that we can actually use to target? So in order to actually characterize prostate cancer, at UCSF, we've been looking at this for over the last decade. This is actually work that is led by Dr. Small and Dr. Fang, where we have biopsied patients, both tumor biopsy, tissue biopsies, as well as liquid biopsies. These are blood-based biopsies, to subject cells to a battery of different tests that I'm just showing you up here. So whole genome DNA sequencing, looking at the DNA, RNA sequencing, looking at the RNA, whole genome bisulfite sequencing, looking at how the DNA is structured differently, et cetera, et cetera. And these studies in the last 5 to 10 years have really set the field in a new direction of thinking about how do we actually treat and think about prostate cancer. So one of the things that we've discovered, for example, is that there are some mutations that are inherited from your parents. We call these germline mutations. And these are the mutations that may be transmitted to biological children and may also affect your treatment. So it wasn't until almost 10 years ago that we started to appreciate that about 12% of men, depending on different studies and different areas of the world that you look at, have a mutation in a DNA repair gene. And if you take a look at the pie chart of what those genes are, what we found very surprisingly was that a gene called BRCA2 was found in about 44% of men, okay? BRCA2 stands for breast cancer associated gene. And so while we had understood that BRCA2 mutations conferred increased risk in women to developing breast cancer, it was underappreciated until the study that BRCA mutations can also affect cancer development in men. The other types of mutations that we think about are mutations that are acquired over the course of your lifetime. So remember that cells are constantly dividing as we age, and we're also being exposed to things that might cause mutations, such as radiation from the sun, et cetera. And so these are what we call somatic mutations. And importantly, these are mutations that cannot be transmitted to your own children, but they also may affect your own treatment. And what I'm listing and showing you here is just the fact that we've now discovered that there are so many different genes that all lead down to the same road of causing prostate cancer. And so I'm just putting a smattering of different genes here that are commonly found in patients that we've biopsied. And what you can see is that different patients essentially have different building blocks of making their cancer. And so what we are trying to do is to really understand these different genetic and genomic building blocks for each individual patient, and thinking about how these building blocks should affect the way that we treat the patient in front of us. So I'm giving you one example of that. So this is actually a study that was published by Dr. Feng almost 10 years ago now. And based on this genomic score that Dr. Feng and his team developed at the time, you can see that there were some patients who had a high score and some patients who had a low score. And what he wanted to ask is, which were the patients that actually benefited from radiation therapy? So if the two lines are overlapping, it means that there was no additional benefit to the treatment that was given. So you can see that patients on the right who have a low genomic score actually did not benefit from radiation treatment. So their cumulative incidence of developing cancer later on down the road in their lifetime was actually the same. Whereas patients who had this high genomic score really, really benefit. See that the red line really gets suppressed. And so these are really the patients that we might want to think about how we incorporate radiation into their treatment plan. Here's another example that was just recently published now, about 2 years ago now, for those BRCA patients who have mutations in BRCA1 or BRCA2. And you can see that this is a treatment that is really targeting the Achilles heel of the cancer, these PARP inhibitors, which do benefit patients who have these BRCA1 and BRCA2 alterations. And finally, what I'll say is that the genetics within prostate cancer actually can alter the proteins that are on the cell surface. We know that these are great proteins that we can exploit for imaging and diagnostic and treatment purposes. And the one that Dr. Small initially mentioned earlier was PSMA targeting that we can use both as a PET scan, as a diagnostic modality, as well as now drugs. And so we are starting to discover that there are certain patients that their genetics actually tell us that they don't have very high PSMA expression. And so here what I'm showing you is immunohistochemistry that Dr. Dingen talked about. The stain for each protein is in brown. So you can see there's not a lot of brown in the middle for this particular patient, but there is a lot of brown staining for another target called DLL3. So discovering a new Achilles heel of surface targets for different patient subtypes that have expression of one protein, but perhaps not the other. And really it's to guide this holy grail of oncology treatments of precision medicine, and that we know that there are patients right now, we group them all together and we just say that you have prostate cancer. But what we really know is that prostate cancer has all these different building blocks, all these different mutations that can confer and lead to a development of prostate cancer. And we're now starting to say, okay, well, patients who have a pink mutation, we should give them a pink pill. A blue mutation should get a blue pill, et cetera, et cetera. And so I just wanted to end and say that it really takes a team, hard work, dedication, and funding to advance prostate cancer research and patient care. And so this is a picture of my own group. So these are all college grads and recent minted PhDs. And so we have a great group of people who are excited about advancing prostate cancer care. But it does take funding from the DoD that funds the CDMRP, the NCI, which is a sub-branch of the NIH. And for those of you who don't know, the Prostate Cancer Foundation also does a lot of funding. And certainly at all levels, from trainees that are new college grads, all the way up to our senior faculty. So with that, I'd like to thank you, and we'll take questions at the panel.